Hi, welcome to the Baptronics Mountain Labs here in Colorado. I'm Bruce, and here to talk to you today about a frequency counter. This is a Fluke 1953A. Before we get to talking about it, though, let's just talk about frequency counters in general. When you're in the market for a frequency counter, there's a number of things you want to consider. Perhaps one of them would be the measurement range. Do you have enough frequency range to handle whatever work you're doing? Number of counters will work 0 to 80 megahertz. Some will go to 100 or 125 megahertz. Others can reach 500 gigahertz, even more. Next thing would be a number of digits. Do you have enough digits on the display that you can accurately and easily display with accuracy what you're trying to? When you're talking accuracy and stability, you start to get into the time base, which really, you know, without an accurate and stable time base, your frequency measurements are gonna vary, and they're not gonna be accurate. Then you got to think about other things that you might want to do besides measuring frequency. I mean, are there other functions provided you? Perhaps a period measurement, maybe measuring time intervals between events, counting the number of events that come through during a particular time. It's a totalizer function. And you got to talk about sensitivity. Is this unit going to be sensitive enough to be able to handle the signal coming in from your gear? And then finally, good looks. I mean, gosh, I love a good-looking instrument. And I if I'm going to have one on my bench, I want to be proud of it. I want it to look good. Can't stand it when they're all scratched up, banged up, which, you know, you're talking about vintage gear. That often happens, so. So now we'll get back to this 1953A. I think this unit has it all. At the time that Fluke came out with it, would have been about 1975, and I think it had about a 10-year run, because I saw some revisions in 85 to the manual. Number of revisions in between. At the time that it came out, you can bet your pants that this was quite an expensive unit. I don't have the data on it. But this unit measured the base unit alone, which in order to keep costs down, they introduce a base unit. A base unit has no options to it. You would have had channel A and B. Channel A would have got you 0 to 125 megahertz. And would have gave you the fact that you had channel B on there, which was 0 to 25. That gave you the functionality so that you could measure frequency A, you could do a ratio of A to B, you could measure the period of A, you could do the time interval between A and B. You could do that with six different ranges of gate time, and you had a number of other options that came with it, or not options, but another functions that came with it. Then then you started to introduce options, which raised the price of the base unit. One of them would have been to have added a channel C, which this one has. Channel C gave you a greater frequency range. In this case, channel C goes from 50 megahertz to 520 megahertz. Now that's probably about as much as I normally would ever use. I do have another one on my bench that gets me to a gigahertz, but I honestly don't even remember ever needing to go over 520 megahertz, but that's, if you have it, you have it. In this case, you can go to 520. Another function was the time base. This particular unit has the second best time base out of four that were offered for the unit. Ovenair oven-controlled crystal oscillator that's in here has an aging rate of plus or minus 1 times 10 to the minus 7th per month, and a temperature stability that from 0 degrees to 50 degrees centigrade only varies plus or minus 1 times 10 to the minus 8. So that gives you some fantastic stability. Now you couple that with a really good calibration against a really solid standard like a rubidium, and that gives you some really fantastic accuracy on top of it, stability and accuracy both. We've got 9 fairly large and bright LEDs. Now in this room light with this particular camera probably doesn't look so much like it, but they are bright LEDs. I can see them easily with my eyes, even in this bright light. And there are 9 of them, so I can measure to the 10th of a hertz, say at 10 megahertz, I can measure right down to the 10th of a hertz, which is what I'm doing right now. I've been warming up the last 10-15 minutes, and we are reading 10 million hertz right down to 1/10 of a hertz. We're 1/10 over, and I believe we're on our way down to evening out. It's cooling off just a little bit inside. It warmed up heavily in the at the startup, overshot, and now it's coming back down again. And then also, this particular unit came with a remote control interface as well, so we've got that option. So those options together give you a rather spectacular unit with some really terrific capability. Now, some other things that are different about it. Almost all counters, you just input the signal, you select your attenuation, and essentially you're counting. There is no control, no trigger level. This has a trigger level to it. If your trigger level is clicked counterclockwise to the preset point, then as you pass the zero point on the signal, so you'll do a zero crossing point count in the preset point. And when you click going clockwise, as you click the trigger level, what you're doing is you are raising at first. You're quite high. You're reading high on the level of the incoming signal, voltage-wise, and saying every time you're at this point, that's where I'm going to count. Channel B, we have 0 to 25 megahertz capability. But what B is used for primarily is as a gate for something that happens on A. So let's say we want to do the ratio of A to B. B can be any signal from 0 to 25 megahertz. A is from 0 to 125. And you can choose to look at the ratio of the two, which might be 2 to 1 or something like that. It also has the trigger level control. Both channels have positive or negative slope. You can choose to count on the plus side of the slope or the negative side of the slope. You can go AC or DC coupling. AC coupling, you go from 5 hertz to 125 megahertz. DC, we go from 0 to 125. And we have an input attenuator times 1 or times 10. And that's on both channels. Then we can either separate the two channels, or we can connect them together so that they're common between, you have a common ground and between the two sides. Our function switch, we can go frequency of A, frequency of C, frequency ratio of A to B. We can do a period measurement of A. If your reason you would do that would be if you're measuring low frequencies, and instead of getting a count on the counter that might read 0.005 kilohertz, you instead read period, and you're going to read 5 hertz as 5 million counts. Yeah, because it's in microseconds. I can choose my gate range to change that, but I could take 5 hertz and make 5 million counts out of it, so I can get a much finer resolution to the actual frequency that I'm working with. We have the cycle control, which kind of controls the update of the display. I usually increase it so I get maximum update. And then we just kind of take a little look at it here. This unit is really beautiful. Now, there's a reason for that. I've given this thing a new paint job. It was scuffed, it was scraped, it was banged up a little bit. But she functioned after I got her working beautifully. So, not having the heart to leave it like that, we had to paint it. So, we've given it as close to the original paint colors that she had. This is a silvered aluminum paint job on the bezel. We had to mask everything off very carefully, and we did. And the results are really quite stunning. The unit really does look new. The knobs are a little worn on the edges from years of being bumped into things, but that's about the only giveaway. And then we look at the case. Case has been straightened up and then repainted. And as close to a Fluke turquoise as I could find, both top and bottom. There's the underside. Beautiful condition. The handle's in good shape. And if we rotate this thing around, take a look at the back side. You can see the sheen of the paint gloss there. And then on the back side, we have a number of inputs and outputs on the back that are available. If that goes good with your bench, then you can do that. We have the remote control access here. We can go internal or external control or clock. And then we have the main power main on-off switch. If I'm on, then my oscillator is staying warm for me. So this unit looks spectacular. I think anybody would be proud to have that. Well, while I had the cover removed, I wanted to give you a look at the interior and just point out some of the things that have been done. All of the pots have been cleaned and lubricated. All of the switches, which are silvered, were badly tarnished, and those have been cleaned and then used some deoxit. D100L on the surfaces again after I got them polished. So those have been revitalized. All of the slide switches on the front panel, they've been spray cleaned and lubricated and operated. The interior was cleaned of dust and dirt collected over the years. So it's looking very nice now. This, by the way, is the Ovenair precision oscillator, 10 megahertz. Beautiful oscillator. That's the second of the best that they had offered for this unit out of 4. Pretty much what I wanted to show you. we'll get her back together and then we'll run her through some tests. Okay, we are in the process right now of calibrating this Fluke 1953A with our rubidium oscillator. The rubidium unit is that back unit up there. We are right now waiting for it to achieve lock. We've turned it on. We've got a red light right at the moment. When it turns green, we'll have lock. And right now it's searching for a frequency. And I've got the frequency of the rubidium coming in on the X channel, and I've got the frequency of my 1953A on the, well, it's the other way around. One's on the Y and the other's on the X. The rubidium's on Y and my 1953 is on the X. And I'm on the XY position of my scope, so I'm comparing the frequencies and I'm getting a Lissajous pattern. And I'm waiting to achieve lock, and then I'm going to check my 1953A frequency and see what it's going to take to stop that Lissajous pattern. That's going to tell me when I've correctly adjusted my 1953A. So let's take a look here. All right, we have a green light. We are in lock, so we should be able to adjust. We do see we have a little bit of a shift here. Small, but it's there. And on the back of the 1953A, I have a fine adjustment for frequency. I'm going to use a small screwdriver. Little jeweler screwdriver here. I'm going to find my slot on the back, which is right in here. To feel around to feel the adjustment screw hole. And then I want to adjust it so that I stop my rotating Lissajous pattern. Just a touch. I believe, yeah, that pretty well got it right there. Okay. We have it really, really close at this point. So that's about it. All right, we're done. Well, as you can see, we've achieved a lock on our Lissajous pattern. We've stopped rotating. Any rotation that's in there now is a very long-term rotation. We're not going to worry about that because that's going to be many digits down on the into decades that we can't measure anyway. But we've stopped the Lissajous pattern, so we're in lock with the rubidium, and that would complete our calibration process on this Fluke. Okay, I've dimmed the room lights, and what we've got right now is I've taken the rubidium oscillator as my input. That would be here. So that's coming from my rubidium source, so I know that's 10 megahertz. And I'm measuring it using the internal time base within the 1953A. And I'm on my 10-second average. And I'm observing the display. And what I'm seeing is, like right now, we've got 9,999,999.9. And now we've just flashed to 10 million. So that would indicate right at the moment that we are within 0.1 hertz of 10 million. And I'm going to guess that if we were to watch several cycles, we're probably more 10 million than we are a tenth off. There's a cycle right there, so we're doing better than a tenth of a hertz at 10 million cycles. So we've calibrated it beautifully. The comparison on the oscilloscope using the X, Y, and slowing down that lissajous pattern has worked very well. Let's move on, huh? Okay, we've connected the Fluke 1953A up to this HP8640B, and we're outputting 540 megahertz right now out of the HP, and we are having no problem reading it on the Fluke. We're getting 539.999678 megahertz, or in kilohertz it'd be 539,999.679 kilohertz. So that we went off of the HP up there just so that we could get the maximum frequency here. Let's go ahead and disconnect from the HP. And let's reconnect to the back of this PTS-250. I can't use my PTS-500 right now because its output is giving me a problem. Okay. All right, we are right now coming out of this PTS-250. We are set for 200 megahertz, and we are reading 200 megahertz right in the nose. Okay, let's go to 100. Let's go to 900. Let's see, this would be 90,000. Right on the money. 80. There you go. 70. Let's speed this up just a little bit. There. 60. 50. We're at 50,000. We now have to change our input from channel C. Got to go to channel A, and that means we have to change our function switch to A, and we now have 50 megahertz, excuse me, on A. There'd be 40, 30, 20 megahertz, 10 megahertz, 9 megahertz, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 900 kilohertz, 800 kilohertz, 700 kilohertz. If we turn up our resolution, it takes longer, so we're going to hold out for a while here. 600 kilohertz, 500 kilohertz, 400 kilohertz, 300 kilohertz, 200 kilohertz. Now we're getting to the point to where we are at the limit here. I can go to 150. There's 150 kilohertz. And then we have to switch generators again. The PTS, although it's wonderful at switching frequencies, this PTS-250 between about 100 kilohertz, 120 kilohertz, and up to 250. Doesn't do well down below. We're going to the low end now, so let's change our input from the PTS 250. We're going to go up here to this HP 3320. Okay. 100 kilohertz. There we are. There's 10 kilohertz. There's 1 kilohertz. This would be 100 hertz. At this point, we might want to go to a little larger. This would be a 1 second update here. Okay, we're getting 100 hertz, no problem. Let's, my reach is a problem here. Let's see if I can do this. Okay, here's 90. This would be 90 hertz. 80 hertz. 70 hertz. 60 hertz. 50 hertz. 40 hertz. 30 hertz. 20 hertz. 10. Go 9 hertz, 8 hertz, 7, 6, 5 hertz. Now this should be the stated limit of the AC input. Let's see if we go to DC coupling. Oh, you know what? We got to change our gate time to a much larger time so we can pick up another decimal of resolution here. All right, there's 0.3. This is on DC. Well, I'm able to resolve all the way down to 0.1 hertz. That's amazing. So we've got our frequency response here. We're going from 0.1 hertz all the way up to 550 megahertz, 540 I guess we did. Not a problem for the unit. Okay, we're looking at period right now. Period of what's going in on A. We've adjusted our gate time to the period average of 10 to the 0 or once every second. And right now we're feeding in a 1 hertz signal, and we're getting about 1,000 milliseconds as a result. So instead of getting a reading of 1, we're getting a reading of 999.9, or at least 990-something. All right, let's go up to 5. That would be the supposed frequency limit we should drop. We get about 200 milliseconds, which would be about right. And if we go to 10, we should get about 100 milliseconds. So we can increase our resolution at this point. About once every second here, we're getting a reading. So we're getting 99.996 milliseconds, or 100 milliseconds. That'd be 10 hertz. This would be 100 hertz, 9.999, and then 1,000 hertz. We can increase our resolution here. And at this point, you might as well switch over and start reading hertz, I suppose. But at least our period is accurate, and we could keep going. If we want to totalize, then what we do is we feed our signal in on the A channel. We turn our function switch to A gated by B, and we have our trigger level position set so that B is in the negative range right now, so we've got a light on the negative. We see that we're not counting. Now, as soon as I make this light, or turn this trigger level up so that we get a positive light, we're going to see this thing start counting. So right now, so we're counting at 1,000 hertz. 8,000, 9,000, 10,000, 11,000. So we're totalizing right now. So that's working fine. Okay, so what I want to do right now is I want to measure the time interval from A to B. But in order for me to do that, I got to have something coming in on B. So there's a switch here that says separate or common. Go ahead and I switch that to common. That puts the same signal on both inputs. I set myself up so that I'm identical on both sides. I've got my attenuator right now at times one. I've got AC signal coming in and slope plus. Both of the channel trigger levels are in the preset mode. And function is on time interval of A by B. And I went ahead and put myself, I'm reading 1 hertz here. So I put myself up in my gate time of 0.1 millisecond, or period averaging of one. I've got one reading a second, so in a second I'm getting 997.6 milliseconds according to the counter. So in other words, 998 1,000, which would be 1 hertz. 1,000 milliseconds is a hertz, so I've got a little error in there. But if I go ahead and turn myself up to 10 hertz, go down to 99.8, 99.9. If I go to 100 hertz, I drop to 9.99. Kilohertz, 0.999, or roughly 1. So the time interval is working too. The last thing is really the self-check. When you go into self-check mode, that's the last position, then if you're in the 0.1 millisecond gate time, you get a reading of 1,000. And if I go to 1 millisecond, I get 10,000. If I go to 10 milliseconds, I get 100,000. If I go to 0.1 seconds, I get 1,000,000. I get 10 million in the 1 second mode. And in the final position, I get 100 million. But it takes 10 seconds to get it. There we go. So if all of those readings come true, then supposedly my counter is working fine. That's the self-check. So the Fluke 1953A really is a feature-packed frequency counter, or universal counter. They call it universal because it has so many other functions. Along with it, I'm going to make sure that you have the user and service manual PDF files. It'll be on the disk. It'll come with it. And I'll also throw in a brand new set of coaxial gator clip leads for just general purpose circuit work. It's always good to have a pair around, and this will get you started if you don't have any coax cables, or depends on what you're using it for. So thank you for listening to me, and wish you all well on the bidding, and till we meet again. Bye. Well, there's a couple of features on this, on the back, that I'd like to go over with you. So I'm going to flip this thing around, and let's take a look at it first of all. You'll notice that on the back, I'm trying to do this one-handed, this is difficult. There are a row of BNC outputs. The top one is marked marker in the middle row, and then off to the right we see gate. Then we go down one, and it says level A, and then clock out. And then down below that, it'll be level B and clock in. Now, We wonder what those are, right? Well, I'm connected to the level A right now. And you'll see that I've got a line going up to my scope on channel B. And I have a line running over to my DBM. And what those two levels do is to allow you to take a reading or a view of the trigger level for A and B channels. So right now I'm hooked up on channel A. I'm looking at the level A coming out of the back. And I've got a signal coming in from my signal generator right here. You can see that I've got the input running up to a dual input up here, and then I have a line running down that comes back to my counter. And what we're looking at right there, you can see the triangle waveform on the top. That's the waveform coming out of my generator. And then that line on the bottom is channel B, and that happens to be my level A output. And also on my DVM, I'm reading the voltage on that level A output at the moment. Now I've got the output all the way clockwise, not on the preset point. I could click it, but just outside of the preset point. So I'm all the way to one end of the level. And you get an idea where the relative line is. If I switch to zero both channels, we see that they lay on top of each other, so that's fine. Right now I'm a negative 1.2 volts from zero, and I'm below the waveform. And I'm not getting a count. But I see that on my indicator I've got trigger status that says I need to be positive, so let's go ahead and adjust this thing. And as I adjust it, you're going to notice that the line rotates up. It's moving up. I'm almost touching the waveform now. And I'm going to watch this trigger status light until I start to see it come on. And that's right about now. So I start to see a fair, really low glimmer of light in the bottom status indicator. And lo and behold, I've started to count, as long as I have that light on. There we go. We've got a count right now of 1,000 kilohertz, roughly a megahertz, which is what I have myself dialed into, is 10 times 100,000 to be a megahertz. And I start reading that when that line is just above the lower end of that waveform. Now, as I start to adjust my trigger level, I'm going to see that the light on the negative side becomes brighter and brighter. I'm still counting, and I see that the line is going up the waveform. And I'm going to still be... I'll be counting as long as I have that trigger light on, which right there I do. I can take that line all the way up to the top of the waveform. And I'm still counting. And I have both trigger lights, but I'm starting to lose the positive. I'm becoming more negative now. Right about there. And I see that happens. I've got 0.6 volts. And I am sitting at the top of the waveform. So if I center myself on a waveform, I've got plenty of signal, and I'm counting just fine. So the question then is, well, what would I do with that? Well, okay. Let's go back down. First of all, it gives you an idea how to center yourself on the waveform. That's so you get your maximum signal. But right now, I'm below the waveform, and I'm not counting. And what if that waveform was setting above zero? Like right now, zero is right there. That's zero. that line that goes through the middle. What if I raised my my signal on a DC so that I am now, everything is shifted above zero, still have the waveform, still the same frequency, but I'm above zero. So I want to count that. Let's put ourselves back on here. So I adjust my trigger level again till I see the light start to happen, which is right about there. So now I'm coming into the waveform. I see it. I can center myself. I'm counting fine. I've still got the megahertz coming in on the counter. And as I get to the top of the waveform, I can see that I'm going to run out of it. The light's going to go out. Right there, I lost myself. Lost the count. Got the count again. I'm centered on the count. And you see I've got both lights when I'm centered, and I'm getting a good count right now. So it gives me a way of having both a visual indicator of what I'm trying to read and what I want to zero in on. The signal I wanted to see was sitting on top of a DC voltage, a signal, and I wasn't going to be able to read it unless I was able to adjust my trigger point up into the area where the signal was. So this gives me a nice visual, and it allows me to read the voltage as well. So I have that on channel A and channel B. I can do the same thing. This should also work for a complex waveform, so long as I have enough of a signal that, you know, if the signal I want to read has to be somewhere by itself. Otherwise, if I've mixed other signals in with it, the count's going to be meaningless to me. But if I can isolate a part of the waveform that I want to see, and then adjust my trigger level to bring me up into that waveform, I'll be able to read it. Okay, we're still exploring the rear panel connectors and what they do for us. And we've taken a look at the level one, and level two is associated with level one. We've looked at what those do. We're going to do a little more with it. But we're going to throw in the marker. This marker connector is meant to feed a signal to the Z input axis on a scope. And that will provide a voltage that will darken and lighten certain portions of the scope trace to indicate what we're actually going to be measuring as a time period when we try to measure the time interval between A and B. And we're going to demonstrate that right now. Right now I have a signal coming in, so 1 megahertz signal coming in off of this generator. I'm feeding it into my my counter, and I'm getting a 1 megahertz output. And I'm gonna go ahead. If I check the period of 1 megahertz, and my period is coming out 0.001 millisecond. So that would be a thousandth of a thousandth, which is a millionth of a second. And that would be the period. It's 1 microsecond. That'd be the period of a megahertz. Well, that's as it should be. But if I put channel A and channel B, click them into the preset position. Let's go ahead and take off the, we're going to put the SEP separate to common position so that we're feeding the signal into both A and B channels. So we want to be common. And I'm going to switch from period to time interval of A to B. Now, what I'm doing right now is I've basically centered myself on the existing waveform, and my off and my on is centered as well. So what I'm getting right now, I'm feeding a triangle signal in, and then
the line in between just shows that I'm adjusted to read the level of that signal midway between the waveform. And I'm getting, again, 0.001 milliseconds as the time interval between the cycles. And that makes sense. I should be. If I'm measuring a whole cycle and then repeating it, then I should have the period of the cycle if I'm going to get the whole time interval. But what if I want not the whole interval, but I want just part of the cycle? That's what this allows you to do. So that's what the marker allows you to do on the Z-axis. Right now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to adjust my trigger levels A and B, and you're going to see some things happening on the scope, and I'll describe them as I'm adjusting the trigger levels. Okay, so right now I'm adjusting A. Alright, I've got A adjusted so that I'm beginning to see the signal on the screen, and I'm adjusting B for the turnoff point. Back down and get the whole signal. All right, go back. If I get the whole signal like that, okay, so if I've got the whole signal showing on the screen like that, and I see that my lights are all lit here and I've dialed them into the middle, mid-range, again, I'm getting basically the period of a 1 megahertz signal. It's 0.001 milliseconds. But if I dial this so that I get only a portion, I'm working on the B right now. I'm adjusting it so I'm seeing a portion of the waveform. Backing off right now, I went a little too far. All right, right there I'm going to take it and I'm going to adjust A a little bit just to make sure that I've got the full half of that triangle wave. There we go. Alright, so now I'm showing half of a triangle each cycle. And the question is, what is the time interval for one half of that cycle? And I'm seeing 0.005, essentially, which is what I'd expect. So I've adjusted myself for half of the cycle. I'm getting a time interval for half of the cycle. Kind of what this thing allows you to do. You can, I could adjust it for less than a half a cycle. I'm going to guess that that's approximately a quarter of a cycle there. Looks like it. And I see that I'm varying between 2 and 3, which would be about a quarter of a cycle. So if I adjust these dials so that I display only a portion of the repetitive waveform that's on the screen, I can measure the time interval for that portion. If that portion was something interesting, like a pulse on a complex waveform, then I've got the time interval of the pulse, and which case I could calculate the frequency. So that's kind of worth knowing. And it gives you an idea what the outputs are for level A and B and the marker, and how you would adjust your trigger levels to use them effectively. You could easily monitor a DVM, a digital multimeter, instead of looking at a scope. But I think a scope gives you a much better picture of what's going on, and especially since you can use the marker output with that Z-axis and do that. You could also measure an interval if you were to feed a signal in, say you had a little digital circuit that provided a positive pulse to channel A, and then
moments later, triggered on some event, you submitted a positive pulse to channel B, you would be measuring the time interval of between those two events. So it does that as well. Okay. So there we have it for the 1953A, and along with that unit, a beautiful counter, I'm going to throw in a set of manuals on DVD. It's in PDF format, both user and service manuals, and I'll also throw in a little universal coax clip lead set just to kind of get you going with the counter. Use that for testing a lot of circuits on your bench. And any other kind of connector you'll be on your own to get. But there you go. You'll be completely set up. And I'm going to wish you happy bidding and thank you for listening. And we'll do it on another piece of equipment next time. Thank you. Bye-bye.